None of us is immune to stress or traumatic experiences, but some of us deal with it better than others. How come? Well, joining us now with some answers, Katie Kamkar. She's clinical psychologist with the Psychological Trauma Program at CAMH, the Center for Addiction and Mental Health. And Katie, it's good to have you back here at TVO.
Thank you so much.
We've been talking so far on the program about operational stress injuries,
yes,
which I guess are more commonly thought of in the family of PTSD, right? Can you help us understand what PTSD is?
PTSD is essentially post-traumatic stress disorder, is an anxiety disorder that occurs when we experience a very upsetting or traumatic event that threatened our body or threatened someone else's life or was a threat to the person's physical integrity, again, threat to the physical integrity of the self or the other. And common response includes intense fear, horror, when we feel horrified or when we feel totally helpless.
So soldiers obviously would suffer from this or be at the top
Definitely.
Of the list, but police officers too, presumably.
Absolutely. So soldiers, war veterans, firefighters, definitely police.
Can people have this disorder and not know it?
Yes, when we do not recognize the signs and the symptoms, we can go on and suffering for a very long time. And by the time we realize it, then the suffering has really compounded. So yes, it is possible.
Okay, we heard some stories about incidents that may have taken place in a police officer's career 20 years ago, and he was quote-unquote fine for 20 years, and then suddenly something would manifest itself. Does that ring true?
You know, it can be possible, but also often what we see is that maybe also initially there were certain signs that might have gone unnoticed. So for example, maybe we didn't have PTSD, but maybe we had nightmares that were still very debilitating, or it could be sleep problems, or dealing with mood irritability, or just avoiding maybe certain responsibilities. So again, substance abuse, we know that is very predominant as well. Substance abuse or dealing with depressed mood or addiction. So sometimes there are certain of those manifestations as well. We're still able to move on and then, again, up to a certain point.
Sure. Are some people more prone to get this than others?
Well, you know, one thing we know through research is that most people, actually, majority of people, well above about 75% of the population, report experiencing at least one traumatic event in their life. But not everyone would go on into experiencing post-traumatic stress disorder. So there are really several risk factors. There are many various risk factors, but there's some that can really increase the risk. So, for example, it has to do with the severity of the trauma. So, of course, the more severe, especially the ones that carry serious injuries to self or serious injuries to others, or witnessing horrific images, horrific accident, horrific things happening to others. Lack of social support after a trauma can also be a significant risk factor, or experiencing significant stress before the trauma, but also after the trauma can also really significantly increase the risk.
I'm wondering if suppressing the emotions that would accompany, let's say you're a police officer on the beat and you see,
yes,
you know, you got to shoot somebody, for example, who's coming,
yes,
at you.
Absolutely.
The emotion of having to, as they say in police culture, suck it up and just, you know, be calm and suppress whatever fears you might be having, does that contribute to PTSD?
We know that the police work is a profession that is significantly demanding. It's demanding psychologically and physically, and also does carry significant impact on various aspects of their life. And as you mentioned, they are exposed to various life-threatening situations, so shootings, witnessing horrific crime scenes. They have also to respond to calls, which also carry a lot of uncertainty,
sure,
that can vary from maybe mild arguments to, again, suddenly witnessing bloody crime scenes, severe assaults. They need to they are exposed at times to severe motor vehicle accidents or calls in regards to chemical spills and so on. So they are exposed and more often than not re-exposed to traumatic events and to various incidents. And yes, the stigma, even though a lot of work has been done over the past decades, the stigma does remain predominant in terms of not wanting to seek help, not wanting to indicate the suffering and the distress, feeling embarrassed or ashamed, or feeling embarrassed, feeling afraid to share and to talk about their suffering.
And do I assume that if you have seen numerous violent incidents over the year,
it does increase the vulnerability.
It does, okay.
It's a really repeated trauma, and you know, as you mentioned, police again, it's a very demanding profession. Where in the culture, within the culture, it does promote psychological strength and physical strength, and it is this idea within the police that to play it tough and to play it strong, and after all, they are here to serve and to protect. But again, they are human beings.
Well, let me pick up on that, because I presume, and you tell me if this isn't the case, I presume the juxtaposition of seeing very violent, horrifying things on the job, and then having to come home and play with your little children and be civilized with your spouse, can that contribute to it as well? Does that make it worse?
In terms of if, you mean not talking about it?
Yeah.
If they are suffering inside, if when we suffer inside and we suppress it, so in other words, we suffer in silence, for how long can we move on? How long can we go on before we reach that limit?
Well, some people they say they can compartmentalize, right? This is my work life.
Yes.
That's over there.
Yes.
I deal with all of the horror over there, but then I can lead a normal life in the other compartment.
Yes.
Is that really true?
Yes and no, and also there are the individual differences, and at the same time, it also depends on how well we are able to do it. I mean, again, we are also human beings, so it's not that, you know, we can leave everything in one basket, and when we move to another basket, we can leave everything behind.
So, can't do that.
Some, again, that clear extreme would be very, very difficult to attain that. So we can sometimes, again, feel the stress, sometimes without realizing it. Sometimes it can manifest with, you know, sleep problems. It could be appetite changes, it could be difficulty concentrating, or mood irritability.
As somebody who studies the brain, would you say that compartmentalizing, you know, lots of people do it, obviously, as a means of getting through the day.
Yes.
Is it a good idea?
Well, if it works, if we are able to separate everything, I think that if it works and we are able to separate everything, we wouldn't really be talk about, you know, work-life imbalance or imbalance in other areas of our lives. So it is very difficult to achieve that. But what I would like to say is that when we suffer and when we talk about suffering from an illness, it's very difficult to do that.
Mm-hmm.
We need help. So if we suffer from cancer, if I have cancer, and I go from this location to another location, I'm going to still have cancer. It's the same concept.
Same concept, even
absolutely.
With
so it is an illness. So that we need to take it very seriously. And it's very important not to suffer in silence. Now, we talk greatly about PTSD. One thing that is also important to know is that also when people suffer from PTSD, it often also associated with comorbid illnesses as well. Depression is a predominant one as well. Substance use and addiction that we talked about as well. So also there are so many other things as well involved in addition to suffering from the symptoms of trauma, but also other things as well, other illnesses as well.
Well, there would be, I guess, I shouldn't make a blanket statement here, but in some circles in police culture, booze is a significant part of that culture, right? You do your shift, you go out for a pop after the shift's over, as they say. That would contribute, I presume?
And you know, the more distress we feel, the more we seek for coping strategies. Alcohol is one of them. Unfortunately, it is an unhealthy coping strategy. That is the issue. So sometimes it starts a little bit, and also alcohol, but also it could be medications, it could be drugs. So they are really within the category, unfortunately, unhealthy coping strategies.
Well, if you don't mind, I know police officers watch this program because they tell me when I see them. Could you offer some advice right now to a police officer who may not know if he or she is suffering from this because they've seen a number of terrible, violent things during the course of their career? What would you recommend?
Definitely, this is a profession that is profoundly demanding. Physically and psychologically, as I mentioned, and does have an impact on various aspects of their life. We know that on the one hand, the role is to protect and to serve, and they are there to assert control and to cope with the disasters. But on the other hand, they're also human beings. So that means that they need resources, they need coping mechanisms, and they need help as well. once again, because they are human beings. So it's very important to recognize what are the signs and the symptoms that we need to seek for. For example, in the case of post-traumatic stress disorder, we have what we call re-experiencing symptoms. So having a very distressing issues of thoughts or images, nightmares about traumatic incidents, experiencing, feeling distress when we are reminded of the events, experiencing reactions, physical symptoms when again we are exposed to the reminders. We as well have avoidance symptoms, wanting to avoid the reminders of the traumas. It could be places or people or situations, wanting to give up the things that we used to enjoy before, so essentially any pleasurable activities. Or when we experience feelings of detachment. There's also hyperarousal symptoms, difficulty concentrating, difficulty sleeping, mood irritability, having outbursts of anger, hypervigilance, constantly being on guard for signs of threat or danger, feeling excessively jumpy. So all of those are normal reactions after traumatic events. However, when we experience those symptoms over and over again over time, they increase over time, so they become prolonged over time, they cause more distress over time, and or they cause an interference in our responsibilities and day-to-day functioning, it's extremely important to seek help. To seek what are resources available and to seek help. It's important not to seek to suffer in silence. Early detection, early prevention, early treatment is key for a faster recovery.
Okay, seek help, you say. And there's one clinical psychologist on the OPP staff, one full-time psychologist, so that's tough. But they do have peer counseling, they say. And however, you're in a culture that basically says, if you're feeling something, brush it under the carpet and just, you know, plow forward.
That is why education is very important. Mm-hmm. Education to raise awareness, to raise understanding, and of course of the resources and again all the coping mechanisms. And we also need leadership in regards to that,
sure,
of the resources and of the policies and so on. So it's an ongoing effort, ongoing work that needs to be done.
But my hunch is the officers in some cases wouldn't either recognize or acknowledge that they have it, but their families may. So if a family has an officer in the family, what should they do?
That can be very helpful, as you mentioned, family. One thing also that we have found to be helpful is peer support groups, mm-hmm, have been found to be helpful for people to realize they're not the only ones suffering. And sometimes also when they hear it, not only from their families, but also from their peers as well, especially their peers sharing referrals and resources, that has also been found to be helpful. But also within the management level, it's very important to increase again the awareness and the education and so on, so that if there are certain red flags going on, so for example, someone doing excessively overtime, someone, let's say, being chronically absent, or increased conflict at work, or essentially any kind of changes, to be approached and say everything is okay, and to be provided with the support, to be provided with the resource. So it's very important to have a very supportive and a collaborative approach among all parties involved.
Can you cure it?
Cure what?
PTSD. If you've got it, can it be cured?
The good news is that, again, with early prevention, early treatment, early detection, there is a good recovery. And the other good news is that we actually have effective treatment.
Like what?
We have trauma-focused, evidence-based treatment. For example, we have trauma-focused cognitive behavior therapy. So this is an evidence-based, research, scientific-based, trauma-focused treatment that has been found to be effective. And it includes psychoeducation, learning, education around anxiety, around trauma, around depression. It does provide anxiety management skills, stress management skills. One of the key components as well is cognitive restructuring.
What
are the thoughts? So essentially, what are the thoughts that are causing me a lot of distress? And learning ways to have better understanding of the thoughts, and also essentially to cope better with the thoughts. So how to switch from negative thoughts, anxious thoughts, or depressed thoughts to thoughts that are even more balanced. Another key component, exposure intervention. So we have situational and in vivo exposures that really help to gradually, very gradually confront the anxiety-provoking situations, places, that we would not avoid before, but now we avoid because, again, of anxiety. There is also imaginal exposure interventions.
What's that?
Imaginal exposure interventions. So this is when we confront, again, very gradually, we confront a feared thoughts, the feared memories. So essentially it gives us better control over the frightening memories, the frightening thoughts, and so to alleviate the fear, but and also to gain better control over the, again, very distressing, upsetting memories and thoughts that we have. So effective trauma-focused treatment is available.
It is available, and how, I don't know if there's an average amount of time it takes if you get treatment to get cured. Is that the right word, cured, or just
To be well-treated, right?
Okay.
Because, again, there's significant individual differences. It does depend, again, on the severity of the trauma. It does depend on, you know, the amount of risk factors. It does depend on how much of the avoidance behaviors we might be engaged in, and also as to when we started the trauma. So, again, the earlier time, the better it is. But, again, it's important to be familiar with the resources to really get the resources, and especially the evidence-based trauma focused
sure.
treatment.
But is this something that takes years to get rid of, if you've got
no,
it?
No, not necessarily. Sometimes it can just take take months, depending again on all the you know, the risk
sure.
factors that I mentioned. But no. But again, as part of the treatment, receiving at times ongoing treatment, ongoing support can also be very helpful. Also in terms of employers providing supportive reintegration into the workforce after a period of absence is very helpful. So meaningful, helpful, modified duties, graduated schedule, graduated modified duties, again, within a very open communication, collaborative, supportive approach among all parties involved, that can really increase the chance for success and recovery.
Understood. Kadi Kamkar from CAMH, always good of you to visit us here at TVO. Thanks
Thank
very much.
Thank you so much.